They don't have teeth, so they don't chew their fish. You see what's going on here?
This is the best horse ride I've ever been on. How am I doing so far?
Watch out for the trees, bro.
And then you want to try to do a howl with me?
There's a million and one reasons I love New England, from its awesome natural range of recreation.
So is it dangerous?
I'm definitely in uncharted waters.
And you're flying.
To its natural beauty.
Man, that was awesome.
This has to be one of New England's best kept secrets. Boston's my town, and I'm gonna show you a side of it you've never seen before.
Let's make some funny TV.
Growing up, I've always had a love of animals. In my household, we had all kinds of pets. But today, we're gonna explore the animal kingdom beyond just pets. Massachusetts is native to many species of wildlife. On the coast, we have gray seals, dolphins, and even humpback whales. And in the forest, we have everything from timber rattlesnakes, black bears, to bobcats and grizzlies. New England is also home to many animal sanctuaries and wildlife preservation centers. Let's explore some of them together and hopefully learn a thing or two about the wild. Our first stop today is at the New England Aquarium in Boston, Massachusetts, the region's largest aquarium. This is home to thousands of aquatic species, such as northern fur seals, California sea lions, and thousands of saltwater and freshwater fish. But today, I'm gonna spend some time with some African penguins, doing one of their favorite activities, and mine as well, feeding time.
How you doing? I'm Rob.
Hi there, I'm Eric. Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you, Eric.
I work with the penguin colony here at New England Aquarium.
I've been coming to the aquarium since I was a kid. It's always been a fun experience for me and my family now. What are we gonna do here today?
This morning we're gonna be cleaning up after our penguins, feeding them, providing the individual care. So we've got a really big team that works together to help make that happen.
Can I help?
Absolutely. All yeah, right. Come on in. Focus on the African penguin feed. It's the larger sized part of our colony. There's a lot of them that are gonna show up for the feeding session this morning, and we're gonna make sure they all get their breakfast.
How often do you have to feed the penguins?
We feed them at least twice daily, but we try to make it unpredictable, the way that we deliver the fish, how often we deliver the fish, just so no day is ever the same. Everything's really stimulating for them, both mentally and physically. So today we'll hand feed them on the island. Sometimes we'll feed them in the water. Sometimes we'll give them little puzzles to solve to get to their fish so that their minds stay really active.
Reward.
Exactly.
Let me ask a silly question.
Sure.
It's freezing in this
water. It sure is.
Right? Yeah. What? You're laughing at me.
Did you hear that? It just so happens that African penguins are also known as jackass penguins because, you guessed it, they make noise similar to a bunch of donkeys braying. Let's just hope their personalities are a bit more laid back.
Why wouldn't you stand up there and just throw the fish for them? Why do we have to get wet suits on and get in the water
Good
to feed
question.
Them?
Our job is to make sure we take the best care of them possible. So we want to get up close and personal with these guys to understand their behavior, to get a close look at their eyes, their beak, their face, how they're walking, how they're moving their wings. All those things are really good indicators for their overall health. And we can step in at any point to provide additional care if it's needed. This is an endangered species. And what I find, a lot of people come into the aquarium, they don't even know African penguins exist, let alone that they're not going to for much longer. So it's our job to connect what they're seeing to the bigger picture and to that story that they have to share. There's only about 3% of their population left in their native environments.
And why is that?
Human-related factors. Unfortunately, it's really overfishing and climate change that's changing all the fish populations, which is having a domino effect. The penguins can't find enough fish to survive or to feed their chicks, and it's setting off this huge imbalance in the ocean. So it's very important for us to connect that story with our visitors so they understand, you know, sustainable seafood is something that will really help to make sure that we can ensure there's healthy ecosystems, healthy penguin populations, while we also learn more about our animals here to apply that research to animals in their native environments.
Yeah, that's really good.
Yeah.
Okay, should we feed them?
Yeah, let's get started. And they should start making their way over to eat their breakfast. So in order to feed the penguins, we kind of hold it sort of like a pencil almost. Our thumb goes on one side, our finger goes on the other, that just helps make sure you've got a sturdy hold. When I feed them, I go towards their mouth, and I wait for them to start swallowing, and then I let go. So we're waiting for that swallowing response, but I'm gonna give you this one.
Okay.
You can go straight towards Good Hope, and I'll tell you when to let go. Let go. Awesome job. You're natural.
Natural.
The other season they go through is nesting season. Typically happens once a year. We do have mated pairs here at the aquarium that mate for each nesting season. And so they'll lay 1 to 2 eggs per clutch, and usually 1 clutch of eggs per year. We're part of an active breeding program called the Species Survival Plan. So we'll actually get together with other AZA or Associations of Zoos and Aquariums places, and we'll slate who should breed with who based on those genetics. Sometimes that means sending a penguin to find a mate somewhere else if they're one of our younger penguins that just hatched. Sometimes that means the penguins will come here to find their mate, or sometimes it's just penguins within our own colony. So that collaboration's really important in our conservation efforts, but it does kind of mean we're playing penguin matchmaker.
Yeah, online dating for penguins.
Exactly.
We got 3 at the New England Aquarium. What do you guys have in St. Louis? This guy's eating all the food.
Seriously, and Guza is one of our biggest eaters.
And nobody else, but like they don't take turns, like he eats until he's done.
They have about an hour, and they know that. So we have penguins that come up right in the beginning. We have penguins that come up towards the end. And there's also brand new faces here, so they're still kind of warming up to what's going on today.
You see what's going on here? That's enough, buddy.
Let's see if she's gonna swallow that one. So you'll notice they swallow their fish totally whole. They don't have teeth, so they don't chew their fish, and that's basically a trait that allows them to eat as many fish as quickly as possible.
Okay. Out in the wild, African penguins live on a diet of small fish, like anchovy or mackerel, a lot of them. They can eat almost 14% of their body weight each day. That's the equivalent of a 150-pound person eating like 21 pounds of food a day.
It's pretty amazing what making sure that they have proper veterinary care, proper nutrition, restaurant quality fish. These are capelin. So these are small schooling fish, very similar to the fish that they would eat in their native environments. They get the top-notch care here, all while we're able to learn more about the species so that we can help to make sure their native environments are more equipped to help them survive. You know, with that decline being caused by humans, it really becomes up to us to do something to fix that. And that really ties into our mission here at the aquarium and our priorities. It's to provide the top-notch well-being for our animals while also helping make sure that we apply that to the native populations. So you can go ahead and hold it a little bit closer to the head so it's not as dangly. There you go. And you're gonna offer Lambert right there.
Lambert, come on, buddy. Nah, he's not having it.
You can see he shook his head no, but the penguin to the left is interested. You're welcome to try her. She's one of our younger penguins to the right here.
You got
a snatcher.
Well, I want to thank you for the time here today.
Thank you so much.
Appreciate it. I've learned a lot. If you guys are in Boston, make sure you check out the New England Aquarium. Check out the African penguin exhibit and practice great conservation. Thank you.
Thanks so much for being here.
Awesome.
It's been a pleasure.
So tell me, what exactly do you guys do here at Wolf Hollow?
So we are a wolf sanctuary and educational facility.
I can't wait to see what we're gonna do here today. Should we get started?
Definitely, yeah.
Chilling out with some African penguins, that was a first in my book. Next, I'm headed to Ipswich, Massachusetts, to spend some time with some North American gray wolves.
How you doing? I'm Rob.
Hey, how's it going? I'm Kevin. Thanks for coming out here today.
Yeah, good to meet you.
So tell me, what exactly do you guys do here at Wolf Hollow?
So we are a wolf sanctuary and educational facility. So we've been here for a little over 32 years. We got our licensure in 1988. We're licensed to the state and the federal government. That's what allows us to kind of have these animals here, do our educational programs.
Right.
And we consider kind of September of 1990 to be our real grand opening, because as an educational facility, that's when we got to start seeing people for the first time. So we host kind of school groups and field trips during the week. And on the weekend, Saturday and Sunday, we have our normal operating hours, tours, presentations, really hoping to kind of provide more information about our friends here, the gray wolf, in that hope of with education comes maybe more advocacy for them. They are an endangered species in our country, and we're really kind of hoping to, keep those protections going for them.
What about personally? Like, how did you get involved?
I've always loved wolves. I've always loved animals in particular. But like many folks, I didn't follow my love into a career at first. I didn't know what I wanted to do. Right. And that's where I ended up really actually very fortunate. I met our director where I was working at a coffee shop in our small town of Ipswich here. And after meeting him and chatting with him for a bit, well, I then found out he was the director of a wolf organization. I rediscovered my passion for the animals here, for the love of them and wanting to keep those protections. So I ended up changing my major in college towards something more science-based and never really left here. And that was close to 10 years ago now.
Wow. So serendipitously, you found your calling, even though you weren't necessarily looking for it, it found you, maybe.
Exactly, yeah.
I can't wait to see what we're gonna do here today. Should we get started?
Definitely, yeah. It's not too fun to talk about wolves if we don't have a chance to see them at the same time now, is it?
Well, let's go
see. Come on.
You know, one of the things I think about when I think about wolves, and I think maybe it's probably just from everything that I've read and heard and seen, is the howling.
Yes.
Do they howl at night?
They howl at night. They howl during the day. Howling is definitely a form of communication, so it can be, you know, say, specific talk. Let's say a territorial howl, you know, letting other wolf packs know this is my home, we've claimed this space, or what we might call a rallying howl, which gathers all of the members of the pack together, often prior to, say, a hunt or something like that, a group cooperative activity. But just like you and me might chat or even sing along with the radio at home, sometimes a howl is just for the sheer joy of it, or because we like the sound of our own voices.
And they're separated, is it because they're in separate packs, or male and female?
So it is functionally essentially because they are in separate packs here. Now all of our wolves generally will start in what we call our main enclosure space, which is this enclosure space right over to the side here that we're actually going to have you pop in between the fences with
okay.
us.
Okay.
Having a chance to kind of see all of them.
In the wild, wolves live in packs of about 4 to 9 members, but the numbers can reach up to 30 wolves until some decide to break off and start their own packs.
So we really rely on what I consider to be a pretty wonderful aspect of them as an animal, which is their high kind of family-based instinct, as well as kind of just a teamwork, community-based instinct, where they make amazing adoptive parents, adoptive family-based animals.
How often do they eat? And what do they eat?
Yeah, so their normal diet here is a mixture of ground meat, bone, organ tissue, and it typically comes in about 5-pound packages. And we're not feeding our adult wolves every single day. More often, we're gonna be feeding them every other day. So one day on, one day off. And it's because their digestion rate, their metabolism is a bit slower than domestic dogs. They're not catching or eating things in the wild every single day. And we also have some supplementary food or donations of food that come to us. Some of those have been from some of our local kind of natural grocers in the area providing us food, as well as some of the farm properties. It's fairly common that, I'll be honest, they're eating better than I am on a fairly consistent basis. I come out here, I'm thawing out Cornish game hens and sirloin steak that's been grass-fed in Maine. I get to go home at the end of the day and find whatever pizza, you know, is still good in the box in the back of my refrigerator. That's my dinner for the night, and they do pretty well. And then you want to try to do a howl with me?
Sure, let's do
it. So once I start, please join in with me.
awesome, man. People don't still hunt wolves, do they?
Unfortunately, they do. So really? They are an endangered species in the United States, but unlike a lot of our endangered species, they actually aren't afforded the full, broad, sweeping federal protections that would be associated with that. Ever since wolves were put on the endangered species list, and they were amongst the very first animals listed, in fact, they were part of the reason for the creation of it, they have been fraught with controversy with people attempting to remove some of those protections. And unfortunately, in 2012, we did lose some of those federal protections in the Northern Rockies area, allowing some of these states like Idaho, Montana, Wyoming, to potentially have kind of wolf hunting seasons, or at least allow it to be up to those individual states.
Yeah, that's a shame that it's coming to that. I have to say, you are a wealth of information, and the knowledge and the education that you're providing is definitely something that the viewers are gonna love, and I wanna personally thank you for.
Well, thank you so much for giving me the opportunity to speak to a broader audience here and inform more folks about wolves and our organization.
Guys, if you wanna do something different, like you've never done before, learn about the wolves, come on out here to Wolf Hollow. They have the education, the training, and I promise you, you're gonna learn something new. Come check them out.
That was the quickest lesson I've ever had. Left, right, pull back, or let's go.
And just make sure that that nose of that horse is not too close to the butt of this one.
Not too close.
Yeah, they don't really like tailgaters.
Okay.
After feeding the penguins at the New England Aquarium and checking out a wolf sanctuary in Ipswich, Massachusetts, I'm ready to go into the wild. Okay, maybe just the next best thing to wilderness in the neighborhood, the picturesque Bretton Woods in New Hampshire, where I'll take a lesson in horseback riding.
How you doing?
Hi.
I'm Rob.
Avery, nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you. I heard you're gonna teach me how to ride a horse today.
Yeah.
I'm excited. How long have you been doing it?
Not too long, probably, you know, actually riding about a year.
It's fun to do?
Yeah, I'd like to say it's fun.
Okay, we're not gonna be racing in any races or anything. It's just like a stroll?
Yeah, just a nice leisure walk.
All right, let's do it.
And then we just have our helmets right over there on that wall. I always suggest starting with a medium and going up or down from
there. Okay, I'll go with that. Are they all for whoever?
Yeah.
Boys and girls, the same?
Oh, yeah. Unless you want the pink one.
Oh, my God. I feel like a jockey already. All right, ready to go.
All right. And then if you want to go right outside, we just bring the horses out there for you.
All right, thank you. Hey, buddy.
And just say hello. You can pet him.
Hey.
He's very friendly.
How are you? Oh, you're a good boy. What do I need to know about riding a horse?
I'll teach you how to stop and steer.
No license necessary?
No license necessary. If you want to come right over here.
Okay.
Put your left foot in.
Okay.
Climb right on up.
Okay.
Heel down, toe up. You're gonna have one hand over here, one hand over here. If you need to stop, pull back with both, okay?
Okay.
Over to the right, just right hand out and over to your right knee. See how you physically turned his head?
Yeah.
And then same to the left, okay?
Got it.
When he's being good, you can loosen up a little bit.
Okay.
All right, but when you need him, you want that nice contact.
Got it.
And then just remember heel down, toe up, how you have it. Do those feel about even, or is this one a hair lower?
Oh, I feel like we can work with it.
All right.
Yep.
All right, and then a few quick things before we get going.
That was the quickest lesson I've ever had. Left, right, pull back, or let's go.
All right, and then a few things. It is just me and you.
Okay.
Just make sure that that nose of that horse is not too close to the butt of this one.
Not too close.
Yeah, they don't really like tailgaters.
Okay.
All right, and then we just go right this way.
Oh, buddy. Okay. I tell you what, it is beautiful out here in nature, though, huh?
It is. I wish it wasn't such a windy day.
Do they not like the wind?
They get what we call spooky in the wind.
Watch out for the trees, bro.
They're just more prone.
I mean,
to be
I don't know. Maybe he doesn't like me.
We also had a deer that was hanging up here as well at one point.
A deer?
Yeah.
Nice.
We
all
have
the wildlife.
We do have a coyote as well, and occasionally, on rare occasions, we have a bear.
What happens if the horse sees a bear?
Depends on the horse. A few of these guys, they get scared of the bear, so when we know that the bear is out, we tend to not use that horse. Other guys, like these two, they see the bear and it's never a problem. They just keep walking.
Yeah.
But they can always smell the bear before they see it or hear it. So then they kind of start acting a little funky.
Luckily, we encountered no wild animals while horseback riding. What you're more likely to witness are scenic views of the Presidential Mountain Range if you explore enough of these trails.
Our biggest issue we ever have out here is saddle slips, and that's when, if you're not keeping your balance,
right,
that your saddle will shift one way more than the other, and then if you don't fix it, the saddle can go under their bellies.
This is the best horse ride I've ever been on. How am I doing so far?
Doing good.
Nice.
Nice and centered in your saddle, you're perfect.
Atta boy. Good boy, Shadow. Come on, buddy.
And then I can take your helmet for you if you'd like.
Yeah. Thank you so much.
Yeah,
that was so much fun. I really appreciate
it. Yeah,
thank
you.
It was great to meet you. That was wild, literally wild. But I had a great time and it was totally worth it.
From feeding African penguins in a giant saltwater tank to learning all about the majestic gray wolf, to finally horseback riding in the beautiful Breton Woods.
Until next time, I'm Boston Rob. We'll see you soon.